Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Padma Gunaratne, President, Sri Lanka Medical Association. We, at this bright noon, are in the process of commencing the month of the SLMA, Sri Lanka Medical Association monthly clinical meeting that we have organized for this month in September in collaboration with the College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka. At the outset, let me thank Dr. Ramani Seneviratne, the president of the College of Ophthalmologists and her team for the commitment and for consenting and for liaising with the Sri Lanka Medical Association in organizing this important clinical meeting that would be of benefit to all, including ophthalmologists, pediatricians, as well as for general practitioners. As a neurologist, I'm well aware of the neurometabolic and neurocutaneous manifestations, the value of neurometabolic and neurocutaneous manifestations, as that per se sometimes would lead to diagnosis and for further management. So there are many occasions that we as neurologists request the assistance of ophthalmologists of their view in arriving at the diagnosis. So the topic of the presentation today is the eyes in children with neurometabolic and neurocutaneous diseases. So far, let me from our side to thank Dr. Achala Balasurya, who is in charge of organizing the clinical meeting, and for her collaborating or arranging this with the assistance of the College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka. So to comment the proceedings, let me invite the case presentation initially for the case presentation to Dr. K. Niruthan, Registrar, National Eye Hospital, Colombo, to commence his case presentation. Dr. Niruthan, over to you.
Thank you, madam. Hope you are audible and you can see the slides.
Yes.
Good morning. Good afternoon, all of you. I'm going to present two cases with regard to children presenting to the ophthalmology department with neurometabolic or neurocutaneous diseases. The first case is an 11-month-old boy who was referred for visual assessment in 2018. With the indication is that he had a developmental regression and afebrile convulsion. He was the eldest child of non-consanguineous parents, and perinatal history was not very significant except for gestational diabetes mellitus. He was born at term by elective cesarean section, and his birth weight was normal, and he had no history of asphyxia or any PBU admissions. His developmental milestones were achieved up to 6 months. And at 10 months, he developed a generalized tonic-clonic convulsions, which persisted more than 30 minutes, but it was not associated with any history or any history of head trauma. He didn't have any family histories of seizure or any other metabolic diseases or neurological disorders. And the immunization was given according to the age. On general examination, his height and weight were between -1 and -2 standard deviations. And he had a microcephaly of 43 centimeters, which was less than 5 centi. And on general examination, there was no neurocutaneous any manifestation, no Mongolian spots. Cardiovascular and respiratory system was normal. On abdomen, there was a hepatomegaly, and there was a hypertony with normal reflexes in the peripheral nervous system examination. His development was well below his age, and with motor and fine motor around 5 months. On ophthalmic examination, he was able to fix and follow, and there was no nystagmus present. He had a divergent squint, with full extraocular movements, and pupils were reactive to light and had a good red reflex. On cyclopegic refraction, he had a with-the-rule astigmatism of minus 4 cylinder, and anterior segment was normal without any corneal clouding or cataract. On fundus examination, there was prominent cherry red spots in both eyes with normal disc and vessels. So here the picture shows the cherry red spot in the above picture, and below picture is to compare with the normal fundus. In summary, the patient had a history of a developmental regression and had a afebrile convulsions. On examination, he had microcephaly, hepatomegaly, and bilateral cherry red spots. These all together pointed towards a neurometabolic disorder, possibly a gangliosidosis. So on investigating this patient, the child basic investigation, the hemoglobin was 8.1, which was iron deficiency anemia, and ultrasound abdomen also showed a hepatomegaly. Otherwise, the basic investigations were quite normal. So went ahead with the genetic studies, and the sample for hex A, hex B, and GM2A genes were sent. And it was found that there was a pathogenic variant was identified in hex B gene, and the activities of the hexaminidase A and both the hexaminidases A and B were pathologically decreased. So a genetic diagnosis of autosomal recessive Sandhoff disease was confirmed. So unfortunately, the patient died at the age of 2 years, and the parents had another child, a girl, who is not affected by the disease, but could be a carrier, as it's autosomal recessive disorder. So here, doing the genetic studies is very important for genetic counseling of the patient. And Sandhoff disease actually has poor prognosis. So what can we learn from this case, from this patient, is that the importance of ophthalmic evaluation in assessing patients with developmental delay and regression should be kept in mind, because with certain conditions, we can ophthalmic findings, we can diagnose some conditions, so narrow down the differential diagnosis, which is very important. And some ocular abnormalities can be detected in syndromic children. Already diagnosed syndromic children, you can detect the ocular abnormalities. And it is very important that they might have some refractive errors which can be associated. And so for visual development, to assess the visual development, we need to do the ophthalmic evaluation. And to detect other coexisting ocular conditions which might not be relevant to the diagnosis. And the second most important thing is the cherry red spot. I'll just bit elaborate on the cherry red spot. Cherry red spot is the finding of the reddish discoloration of the fovea, which is in the center of the macula, with pallor surrounding the fovea, that is in the macula. That is because of the anatomical structure of the retina. Retina is a transparent tissue with the ganglion cells are absent in the fovea, and it is much more 2 to 3 layers of ganglion cells are there in the perifoveal region. This is for the getting the clear vision. In pathological states, the ganglion cells, there can be accumulation of substances which can lead to reduction in the transparency of the retina. That is why you get the pale color. But here the underlying pigment and the red color because of the choroidal vasculature is shown as the reddish color. So this is the pathophysiology behind the cherry red spot. So actual cherry red spot, sometimes we might not see in our patients because we are much more pigment darker in color. So the it can mimic like a black spot. So cherry red spot can be presenting like a black spot. So there are differential diagnosis for cherry red spot, which we have to keep in mind. The one we are discussing is about the storage disease, cherry red spot. There are multiple causes. The most frequent ones are seen in gangliosidosis type B, galactosidosis, and sialidosis type 2. Here, the storage material reduces the transparency, and it's usually bilateral. And central retinal artery occlusion, Berlin's edema, drug toxicity, and inflammation. Here the pathology is due to the retinal edema usually. And it can be bilateral or unilateral. And for trauma and vascular causes are due to usually unilateral. With time, in storage diseases, with time, the accumulation of these materials leads to the loss of the ganglion cells, and the optic atrophy takes place because the optic nerve is made of the axons of the ganglion cells. So optic atrophy. So cherry red spots can be lost with time. So there can be optic atrophy without cherry red spots with time. So this is about the first case. We will discuss more about this in the second will be discussed by the second speaker. So the second patient was a patient 11 month old, born to a non-consanguineous parents who had a first pregnancy, which was a miscarriage, and this was a twin pregnancy. Of the twin, the boy had a large left eye with cathola spots and presented in 2018. He was born by C-section at 36 weeks and was treated for neonatal jaundice. And cathola spots actually was noticed later on, not from birth, it's something. And there was no history of seizures and developmental milestones were achieved normally. At 2 months, the mother has noticed some epiphora with mild discharge from 2 months of age. And at 5 months, there was poor lid closure in the left eye, which was prominent while sleeping. And there was no history of photobovia or blepharospasms and no family history of neurofibromatosis. This is the picture of the child. Actually, it's now, that is at 3 years of age. You can observe that the left eye is larger. So on ophthalmic examination, he had a normal lid and adnexia, and the globe was buophthalmic left eye, and intraocular pressure was high in the left eye, which was 30. Anterior segment, the cornea was hazy, no leech nodules were there, and posterior segment, there was a optic nerve cup disc ratio of 0.75, and the axial length was significantly higher in the left eye. On general examination, he had cathola spots mostly in the back and the extremities. No axillary or inguinal freckles. And at that time, our impression was a secondary glaucoma, most probably due to neurofibromatosis. But the proptosis cannot be excluded because in buccal also, you can get a pseudoproptosis. So as neurofibromatosis is associated with optic nerve glioma in at least 15% of patients, we went ahead with doing a MRI brain to exclude optic nerve glioma. And it was normal at the time. Topical anti-glaucoma medications were started at the time and planned for examination under anesthesia. On examination under anesthesia, there was a minus 11 spherical change in the left eye with high IOP of 32. And the corneal diameters were larger in the left eye. Normal at 1 year, it's 10 to 11.5 is normal. Here, 12.5 or more is significant. And as he had features of glaucoma, he underwent the Ahmed glaucoma valve implantation in 2018. This is the Ahmed glaucoma valve, which is shown in the picture. And this is the tube which is placed inside the anterior chamber. So refractive correction was given with glasses and amblyopia management started. In 2020 March, he was while he was following up, he was noticed to have this left-sided temporal bulge. Prominence was seen. So went ahead with doing an MRI, and then as there was some bony changes, he went ahead with doing an NCC, non-contrast CT scan. The non-contrast CT scan, you can see the left eye, it's larger than the right eye with the AP diameter is increased. And you can see the sphenoidal dysplasia, and there is a temporal soft tissue thickness. In the below picture, you can see supranasally, there is the glaucoma Ahmed valve. This is the 3D reconstruction of the skull, and you can see the sphenoidal hyperplasia and the defects in the bone. So he was referred to the pediatric neurologist and the neurosurgeon, and orbitotemporal plexiform neurofibroma with sphenoidal dysplasia and the cathola patches. So all these three things favored the diagnosis of a neurofibromatosis type 1, the diagnostic criteria, which will be discussed by the next speaker. We will see up more about it. And he was planned to follow up with serial scans, and ultrasound abdomen was done to exclude other associations. and glaucoma management was continued with topical medications after the surgery also, and refractive correction and amblyopia treatment is being continued. So what we can learn from this case is that if a patient comes with a large eye, what we have to think of? So whether first thing is to explore whether it's a large eye or it's mimicking as a large eye. Sometimes the in the first picture, as you can see, the child can have a microphthalmos in the other eye or ptosis or a large cornea, which large cornea in the other eye. So it can mimic a large eye, or whether it's due to proptosis. Proptosis is forward protrusion of the globe in relation to the orbit. Exophthalmos is a term which we use more commonly in thyroid eye disease. Buophthalmos is enlargement of the globe. It's more or less more often due to high intraocular pressure, and you will have a hazy cornea because of the high intraocular pressure. So buophthalmos, the name comes from the ox eye, that is ox eye in Latin is buophthalmos. So when a patient comes with unilateral buophthalmos, we have to think of certain conditions if there is no obvious systemic findings like papular patches in this child. So it could be due to primary congenital glaucoma, which is usually bilateral, but bilateral is usually 60% to 80%. So it can present as unilateral buophthalmos also, or secondary glaucoma. Secondary glaucoma could be due to ocular systemic. Ocular causes, we have to think of congenital and acquired. Congenital, there could be anterior segment dystenesis or aniridia. Acquired causes are multiple: trauma, tumors, infections, uveitis, steroids, and previous surgery. Tumors sometimes can present like that, especially in neuroblastoma. Systemic Sturge Weber's neurofibromatosis type 1, Lewy syndrome, and other lens associated like Marfan's can present with unilateral glaucoma. So in neurofibromatosis 1, why they develop glaucoma is usually they can have angle abnormalities, so secondary angle torsion. And they are most often associated when they are present with lid cleftiform neurofibromas. So the discussion on neurofibromatosis will be continued by the second speaker. I thank the college and the Sri Lanka Medical Association for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. K. Niruthan, for that very comprehensive and clear presentation to cases. So if we'll move on to the next part of the presentation, it would be a review lecture related to the cases by Dr. Hiranya Abhisekara, consultant pediatric ophthalmologist, Lady Ridgeway Children's Hospital, Colombo. Over to you, Hiranya.
Thank you very much, madam. I would like to thank the College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka and the Sri Lanka Medical Association for inviting me to do this lecture. So many neurometabolic and neurocutaneous diseases present in childhood with ophthalmic manifestations. Some of the conditions have characteristic ophthalmic features, so we can help the pediatrician to diagnose the condition. Some other conditions have ophthalmic complications, and the children will have significant effects on development of the vision. So we'll first consider neurometabolic diseases. Trying to enumerate all the neurometabolic diseases, I think it's an attempt like counting stars. So what I have done is I have grouped the neurometabolic diseases into several constellations, and we'll go through each of this group and try to elaborate on the ocular features. First, we'll consider lysosomal storage disorders, or LSDs. This is a resulting defect in lysosomal enzymes, receptor targets, activator proteins, membrane proteins, or transporters, which leads to accumulation of specific substrates within the lysosomes. So this is a classification of lysosomal storage disorders. Perhaps the most known is mucopolysaccharidosis. Ocular manifestations can occur in cornea, lens, macula, and there are neurological features. Retinopathy can occur, glaucoma can occur, as we discuss in the, as we progress in the discussion. So in the cornea, what we can see is diffuse clouding. Cornea verticillata is another feature. In the lens, we can see characteristic types of cataracts in certain conditions. In the macula, we can see a choroid spot, bullseye maculopathy, neurological features, optic atrophy, and ocular metapraxia. First, we'll consider diffuse corneal clouding in lysoma storage disorders. This happens in mucopolysaccharidosis type 1, 4, 6, and 7. Also, this occurs in sialidosis type 1 as well. This is due to deposition of glycosaminoglycans within the corneal stroma and progressive diffuse corneal opacification. And it gives rise to the typical ground glass appearance. In mild corneal clouding, the patient is asymptomatic, but when the opacification worsens, photophobia and the vision is affected. Glycosaminoglycan deposit increases the corneal thickness as well. This confuses us when we check intraocular pressure, because corneal thickness is one determinant factor of intraocular pressure measurement. So this is a cornea verticillata. This is like a whirl-like lines radiating from a single vortex on the surface of the cornea. This occurs in Fabry's disease, and fortunately it does not affect vision in the patient. So this is a case we reported last year at LRH, a cornea verticillata in Fabry's disease. Characteristic cataract in lysoma storage disorders. In mucopolysaccharidosis type 4, punctate lens opacities can occur. Sialidosis also, punctate lens opacities, as shown in this picture, can occur. In alpha melanocytosis, posterior cortical cataract with multiple discrete clear round vacuoles can happen, but I couldn't get a picture to show. So I think the previous speaker talked about choroid spot. Choroid spot is perhaps the most well-known feature in lysosomal storage disorders. This is the choroid spot. So you can see this is the picture of the retina. It's a cross-section, live cross-section of the retina. In the inner layers, you can see deposition of glycosaminoglycans, depositions, and the resulting opacification compared to a normal healthy person in the bottom picture. Retinopathy, or what we call retinitis pigmentosa, can happen in these conditions. Progressive retinopathy can happen in mucopolysaccharidosis type 1, 2, and 3. So it starts with night blindness and problems with peripheral vision, because it starts the peripheral retina first. There's retinal pigment epithelial atrophy and pigment clumping with arterial narrowing and optic dyspello, and finally come to macular changes. Bullseye maculopathy, as shown in this picture, can happen in Batten's disease. This is due to the atrophy of the retinal pigment epithelium. Optic neuropathy is another feature in lysosomal storage disorders. This is due to glycosaminoglycan deposition in the ganglion cell. It gives rise to the full appearance or edematous appearance of the optic nerve head due to enlargement of the nerve. Meantime, the glycosaminoglycans deposit also in the sclera, which constricts the scleral canal, which is there at the exit of the optic nerve. So this causes optic nerve compression and subsequent optic atrophy. Raised ICP also lead to profound optic atrophy and profound visual loss in these patients. Glaucoma was discussed in the case. So the glaucoma can happen in accumulation of glycosaminoglycans within the anterior segment, resulting in a narrow angle. Or it can happen within the trabecular, if the glycosaminoglycan deposition within the trabecular network cells leading to open angle glaucoma as a result of outflow obstruction. This happens in mucopolysaccharidosis type 1, 2, and 6. Oculomotor apraxia is seen in Gaucher's disease. I got a short video here. So this is basically due to the inability of the patient to initiate saccades. So therefore, it is called saccadic initiation failure as well. So there's a dissociation between the eye movement and the head movement in rapid eye movements. The pursuit or the slow eye movements are preserved, so patient can move the eye low, follow a slow target, but if the patient is asked to swap the eye from one target to the other rapidly, there is an initial head thrust. So we were in the mitochondrial disorders. Examples are Leber's hereditary optic atrophy, Kearns eye syndrome, autosomal dominant optic atrophy, and there are eponymous syndromes, very rare. So the features are ptosis, external ophthalmic pigmentary atrophy, optic atrophy, pigmented retinopathy, cataract, cortical visual impairment. And conditions like Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy have only ocular manifestations. The next group is paroxysmal diseases. Paroxysms are organelles involved in the synthesis of myelin, bile acids, isoprenoids, and the oxidation of very long chain branched chain fatty acids. Examples are Sellweger syndrome, Refsum's disease, X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy. And so this is a hyperoxaluria case. The child has developed corneal the retinal scarring due to subretinal neovascular membrane. So the vision was very poor. So retinal dystrophies, they are in these cases. So we'll move on to carbohydrate metabolism errors. Perhaps the most well-known cause is galactosemia. This autosomal condition, autosomal recessive condition caused by deficiency of enzyme galactose 1-phosphate uridyl transferase. This is there's cataract due to accumulation of galactic oil within the lens. And the oil droplet like cataract because of early cataract is seen through the red reflex. So this can be prevented with early diagnosis and implementation of galactose restricted diet. We'll move on to errors of amino acid metabolism. First one is homocystinuria. So this leads to subluxation of lens or ectopia lentis. The lens typically subluxate inferiorly, and finally the lens can dislocate into the anterior chamber, causing pupillary block and resulting glaucoma. Gyrate atrophy is due to raised plasma ornithine levels. There's chorioretinal degeneration and progressive loss of vision. This also can be treated, or progression can be arrested by arginine restricted diet. Cystinosis is another cause. This leads to corneal deposition of cystine, the corneal crystals. The treatment is cystiamine eye drops because oral cystiamine does not affect the cornea. Tyrosinemia type 2 is an autosomal recessive condition. This is due to deficiency of tyrosine aminotransferase. The initial manifestation is ocular signs during the first year of life. They develop photophobia, pain, and conjunctival redness. So this is the symptoms are due to pseudodendritic keratitis. So it looks like a fungal ulcer or viral ulcer in the cornea. Then finally, when this becomes chronic, the neovascularization and corneal scarring occurs. The patient can develop painful erosions and hyperkeratosis in palms and soles. Patients also have cognitive impairment as well. The copper transport disorder, Wilson's disease, the most known condition. Copper transport mutation in the Golgi apparatus of the hepatocyte is the cause for this disease. This impairs biliary excretion of copper, and there's accumulation in the liver, kidney, cornea, and brain. So deposition of copper in the peripheral cornea at the decimus membrane leads to golden brown pigment known as KF ring. So in this picture, it's a very exaggerated picture. We don't see this type of severe KF ring in our clinics. Usually we have to look through the slit lamp to detect very early KF rings. Sometimes we have to do the procedure called gonioscopy to look into the very edge of the decimus membrane to detect early KF ring. The Wilson's disease also lead to ocular gyric crisis. So this is involuntary upward movements of the eyes and blepharospasm. So all the eye movements are involuntary. So we'll now move on to neurocutaneous diseases. That is the next category we are going to discuss. These known as phacomatous as well. These diseases have neurologic, ophthalmologic, and cutaneous manifestations. We'll go to neurofibromatosis first. Neurofibromatosis is a diverse genetic condition with a predisposition for tumor development. There are two types, NF1 and NF2, as we know. This is a diagnostic criteria for NF1. So what is important as far as the ophthalmologist is concerned, detecting Leech nodules. Leech nodules are melanocytic hematomas. These are dome-shaped, discrete lesions on the anterior surface of the iris, usually bilateral. And the diagnostic criteria is to find more than two. By the age of 2.5 years, nearly 1/3 will have Leech nodules. By the age of 5 years, nearly half will have Leech nodules. By the age of 15 years, nearly 75% of them have Leech nodules. And in adults over 30 years, almost everybody with neurofibromatosis will have Leech nodules. So this occurs earlier than neurofibromas. So it's a very good indicator of diagnosis. So these are Leech nodules. They vary in color and size depending on the iris color of the patient. Now, ectropion uveae and glaucoma was discussed by the previous speaker in the case. So ectropion uveae is externalizing the margin of the pupil. So this is a good indicator that the patient will develop glaucoma. So we have to follow up these patients regularly to detect glaucoma. Skeletal anomalies was also discussed, absent of lesser sphenoid wings in the case. So this is optic nerve glioma due to neurofibromatosis type 1. So this is proptosis. You can see the eye is moved. Eye is moved upwards and laterally. So this is not preophthalmic. The size of the cornea is as the same as the other eye. Only just it has moved from its size, its sight. So there is proptosis. And the patient has lost the vision due to the tumor and involvement of the optic nerve. So this is a fusiform tumor at the optic nerve extending up to the, even up to the chiasma. And most cases diagnosed below the age of 7 years, the optic nerve glioma, median age is 4.9 years. So whether we should screen these children or not for optic pathway gliomas, the ophthalmology fraternity is divided. Certain people say yes, certain people say no. So what we do in Sri Lanka, we do screen them as a good medical practice, despite the absence of guidelines. So we see them every 3 months during the first 2 years, and after 2 years, up to at least 8 years, 6 to 12 months. So we aim at diagnosing glaucoma and optic early diagnosis of optic pathway gliomas. So we check visual acuity in each eye, color vision when possible. So to check color vision, child has to be a little older, at least 5 years. But pupil reaction can be checked even in a neonate. So it gives the clue of initial involvement of the optic pathway. These children have refractive errors, so correction then is very, very important. Intraocular pressure measurement is a little bit tricky in very small infants, but now we have rebound tonometers, which is very user-friendly and can be used even in neonates. Fundus examination is mandatory, so it will give the early clues of optic atrophy in early stages. NF type 2, these characterized by bilateral vestibular schwannomas, multiple CNS tumors, cataracts, and retinal abnormalities. There are two patterns of presentation. The mild disease presents later, and the severe disease is the childhood onset disease. So these are the diagnostic criteria for NF2. The ocular findings are early diagnostic markers. 55 to 87% of the affected people have presenile central posterior subcapsular encephalitis, that is cataract. Usually very, very little effect on the vision. So this cataract is very subtle. You have to dilate and have a look. Otherwise, this cataract is not visible. Patient's vision may be normal. Later on, when the tumors develop, patients will develop the effects on corneal anesthesia and reduced blinking due to facial involvement. So epidural membranes can be seen in most of the patients, but usually the vision is not affected to a greater extent by epidural membranes. Combined retinal and retinal pigment epithelial hematomas occur in nearly 1/5 of patients with NF2. If this occurs in the posterior pole, close to the disc and macula, this causes reduced vision. Optic nerve sheath meningiomas is the other feature which can occur in these patients, but that doesn't occur in children usually. So these are hematomas, or can occur in fundus. This is a peripheral one. This is a posterior pole one, which is involved in the disc and the macula. So we have to do ophthalmological examination in F2 patients yearly from infancy to detect cataract. So the diagnosis is made and the appropriate follow-up can be made. Tuberous sclerosis is the next condition. This is a multisystem disorder of cell migration, proliferation, and differentiation. This is characterized by hematomas growths commonly affecting the brain, skin, kidneys, eyes, and heart. The clinical features were divided into two groups, major and minor features, and the diagnostic criteria is divided into definitive tuberous sclerosis when the presence of two major features or one major plus two minors. The probable diagnosis is made one major plus one minor. The possible tuberous sclerosis is either one major or two or more minor features. So ocular features of tuberous sclerosis is the most well-known thing is a retinal hematoma. One of the major diagnostic criteria found in nearly half of patients during the pediatric age group. During childhood, retinal hematomas are not calcified. Otherwise, it's very easy to mistake these for retinoblastoma. So absence of calcification makes it a clear diagnosis in children. So the ophthalmologist's role in tuberous sclerosis, we have to do screening to detect the fundus lesions so diagnosis can be made. And these children usually have effects on vision. They have cortical problems, so cortical visual impairment is there, but what we can correct. Refractive errors, strabismus are common, so we have to correct those things because it can be corrected. And if the patient is on bigobacterium, we have to monitor for visual field defects, but it's a little bit difficult to assess visual field defects in young children and in children with behavioral problems. So if it is an older child, cooperative child, we can do automated perimetry. Otherwise, we have to go by other clinical methods to detect visual field defects. So screening, the fundus examination has to be done in tuberous sclerosis patients and the suspect cases to detect fundus abnormalities. VHL is a benign gives rise to benign ocular vascular tumors, which is known as retinal capillary hemangioblastoma, so RCH. There's a CNS angioma. The ophthalmic features are retinal capillary hemangioblastomas. This is usually not congenital, so we don't see this in very young children, but it can happen, but usually happen in elderly age group. So diagnostic criteria is given there. Ophthalmic screening is recommended yearly from infancy. Sturge-Weber syndrome is a sporadic condition. There's an angiomatic vascular malformation open the face, eye and CNS. Diagnosis of Sturge-Weber syndrome is based on having two out of three diagnostic criteria, which are facial porcupine birthmark, increased intraocular pressure or glaucoma, leptomeningeal angiomatosis or convulsions. Ophthalmic features in Sturge-Weber, the glaucoma is present in majority of patients. There's a bimodal presentation, early onset due to angle anomaly with trabecular dysgenesis. Late onset is due to raised episcleral venous pressure. There are choroidal vascular malformations due to diffuse hemangiomas. Ataxia telangiectasia or Louis Barr syndrome. This gives rise to conjunctival telangiectasia. This appears around the first decade of life, and this is caused by ultraviolet light. So it can be prevented or can be arrested by using UV filter lenses. Incontinentia pigmenti is characterized by inability to vascularize the extreme peripheral retina. So it's a mimic of retinopathy of prematurity. So this leads to tractional retinal detachment and loss of vision if not detected early and treated properly with laser treatment. So screening of these children has to be done affected females. We don't get males because this is lethal for males, this condition. Retinal examination every 2 months for the first year of life, then 4 monthly for the next 12 months, and then 6 monthly. So even the retinal examination are not detected in the first examination, we have to follow up this guideline. And sometimes we have to do examination under anesthetic, particularly if the child is uncooperative and if we are not sure whether the peripheral retina is vascularized or not. So less treatment is the treatment indicated. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hiranya, for that excellent presentation, where you covered almost all segments of the metabolic disorders that are associated with the ocular manifestations. So now for us to move on to MCQs and picture quiz. So let me invite Dr. Travisha Udupihilla, consultant pediatric ophthalmologist, Sirimao Bandaranaike Hospital for Children Peradeniya, to make her presentation that would be a MCQs and picture quiz. Over to you, Travisha.
Thank you very much, madam. And I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the college and the SLMA for having given us this opportunity. So we'll be doing some MCQs and it should be followed by some picture quiz. So I'd like to invite Dr. Chanika Gamage, Senior Registrar in Ophthalmology at the National Eye Hospital, to commence proceedings. And we'll be discussing MCQs and the pictures as they are presented. Over to you, Chanika.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam. Let's move on to the, good afternoon, everyone. So let's move on to the MCQs and the picture quiz. We'll be discussing a few MCQs and a picture quiz. So I will be giving out the MCQs. Okay, sorry for that. So let's move on to the MCQs and the picture quiz. There'll be a few MCQs and some picture quizzes where I'll be giving the questions and Tavisha sir will be continuing with the discussion. So first we'll move on with the MCQs. This MCQs and pictures are based on the previous review lecture. The first one is regarding neurofibromatosis type 1. There are 5 stems and there can be more than one true answer. First one, cafe au lait spots increase in size and number during the first decade of life. Leech nodules are present in all adults with neurofibromatosis type 1. Subcutaneous neurofibromas are present at birth. Optic chiasmal glioma is a feature not associated with any hematological malignancy. I will give some time for you to come up with the answers. If there are any volunteers, you can answer also. Here are the answers. Tavisha sir, it's over to you.
Yes, cafe au lait spots and leech nodules, I mean, they increase with over time. And leech nodules will be almost universally present in adults with neurofibromatosis. And the cafe au lait spots also increase over time. subcutaneous neurofibromas are also not present at birth, but they come up later in life gradually. And as you saw previously, you can get gliomas of the optic nerve or the optic chiasma, and they tend to increase gradually over time. And with regards to malignancy, they can be associated with multiple malignancies, including bone tumors and also leukemias. So hematological malignancy, that is also false. Right, shall we move on to the next one?
Yes, sir. The second one is also again regarding a neurocutaneous syndrome, which is tuberous sclerosis. Most frequent ocular manifestation, retinal astrocytic hematoma. A retinal phacoma is usually found in the peripheral retina. Retinal phacomas give rise to severe vision loss associated with cardiac rhabdomyosarcoma, mulberry lesions seen on direct ophthalmoscopy. So here are the answers.
Right. So, yes, so the most frequent manifestation, ocular manifestation, is the retinal astrocytic hematoma. It's also called a phacoma. Now, these are usually found in the posterior pole of the retina, that is in the region of the disc and macula and around it. And they don't usually occur right in the middle of the fovea. So because of that, they don't give rise to severe loss of vision. And these sometimes aggregate together to form what are called mulberry lesions, especially if they're calcified. And because they are normally found in the posterior pole, they can be seen using direct ophthalmoscopy. So it's easy to spot them. And also there is an association, I think Hiranya read out a long list of associations. So cardiac rhabdomyosarcoma is one of them. Right, so we can move on.
Okay, so this is a broad question regarding neurocutaneous syndromes. Glaucoma is the most common ocular complication in Sturge Weber syndrome. Glaucoma associated with Sturge Weber syndrome is easily treated with medical management only. Incontinentia pigmenti affects the skin, brain, and the eye. Incontinentia pigmenti can mimic retinopathy of prematurity. In ataxia telangiectasia, conjunctival telangiectasia is the earliest ocular manifestation. So here are the answers.
Right. So yes, with regard to Sturge Weber as ophthalmologist, the main thing that we are worried about is glaucoma, because glaucoma is very difficult to treat. The main reason, as Hiranya explained, there is a problem with the increase in the epistheral venous pressure. So a lot of the glaucoma drugs act by either reducing synthesis or increasing drainage. But when there is an increase in the epistheral venous pressure, most of these drugs become ineffective, especially the ones which increase drainage. So it's very difficult to treat medically. And because of that, most of the time, you have to go for surgery to bypass the epistheral veins and directly deliver the anterior chamber fluid into the subconjunctival space where they can be absorbed easily. With regards to incontinentia pigmenti, yes, they affect the skin, brain, and eyes. And with regards to the eye, the dreaded complication is a tractional retinal detachment. Now, this is very similar to what happens in a retinopathy of prematurity. And it has to be detected in time. And if you detect it in time, you can treat the avascular retina with ZACE, and that will prevent this detachment. So that is something that we screen for regularly, and it has to be sorted out. There are three ataxia telangiectasia, yes, conjunctival telangiectasia does occur, but the usual early presentation is oculomotor apraxia. I think you all saw a video of that. And so if you see that, you have to watch out for ataxia telangiectasia later in life. Okay, thank you, Chanika.
Next slide. Okay. True or false regarding albinism, the severity of visual impairment is proportional to the degree of foveal hypoplasia. Abnormally small number of fibers cross at the optic chiasma. Normal visual evoke potentials can be associated with bleeding tendencies or recurrent infections. Need to limit exposure to sun. So the answers.
Thank you, Shanika. Yes, so the basic issue for the ophthalmologist is hypoplasia of the fovea, because sometimes it's totally aplastic and you get nerve fibers going over the fovea and vessels going over the fovea. In effect, there is no fovea. But some kids will have some degree of development of a fovea. So if they have some kind of fovea, they have better vision. And if the fovea is better developed, they will have even better vision. So at the optic chiasma, in a normal child or normal patient, normal person, about 50% of the fibers will cross at the chiasma, and the 50% will go to the direction. However, with regards to albinism, about 85 to 95% of the fibers will cross at the chiasma. And this is one of the causes of abnormal visual evoked potential, because if you test it using the hemispheres differently, you'll get an abnormal reading because of this increased crossing. And bleeding tendencies and recurrent infections, so that is due to Chediak-Higashi syndrome, which is one of the types of albinism. Now, albinism is not one condition, but about 90 different conditions. So Chediak-Higashi syndrome is one of them, and they have fragile capillaries and they can be prone to increased recurrent infections. And because they have limited amounts of pigmentation, you need to reduce the exposure to sun, because ultraviolet light will damage their skin and give rise to skin malignancies. Okay, next question.
Regarding inborn errors of metabolism and their ocular manifestations, tyrosinemia, corneal pseudodendritic ulceration, homocystinuria, anterior lenticonus, gangliosidosis, cherry red spot, Hurler syndrome, corneal clouding, galactosemia, corneal crystal. So answers.
Okay. Thank you, Shanika. Yes, so I think Hiranya showed you a picture of pseudodendritic ulceration of the cornea, which is present in tyrosinemia. And homocystinuria, yes, what was the association? Usually a subluxated lens. Anterior lenticonus is a feature of Alport syndrome, not homocystinuria. So gangliosidosis, yes, cherry red spot, we all saw that. Hurler syndrome gives rise to corneal clouding. Most of the leukopolysaccharidosis do cause corneal clouding, except for Hunter's. Galactosemia, again, we saw that. The main feature is an oil droplet-shaped cataract. Corneal crystals will come to some MCQs later. Right, thank you.
Okay. Which of the following neurocutaneous syndromes are correctly matched with their mode of inheritance? Ataxia telangiectasia, autosomal dominant. Sturge-Weber syndrome, autosomal dominant. Incontinentia pigmenti, X-linked dominant. Tuberous sclerosis, sporadic. Wyburn-Mason syndrome, sporadic.
Right, so as we all know, ataxia telangiectasia is an autosomal recessive condition, and Sturge-Weber is sporadic. With regards to incontinentia pigmenti, it is an X-linked dominant condition, you may remember it's one of the very few conditions that are that have an X-linked dominant inheritance. Tuberous sclerosis is again autosomal dominant, and Wyburn Mason is sporadic. Yes.
So this is regarding Fabry's disease, which is a disorder of fat metabolism. Which of the following are features of Fabry's disease? Skin lesions, renal disease, corneal opacities, heart disease, painful extremities.
Right, so all true. There are some characteristic skin lesions, especially around the groin area. And they are associated with renal failure. And corneal opacities, I think we saw also a picture, corneal verticillata, vortex keratopathy of the cornea, which is seen in Fabry's disease. And there are some other drugs which cause similar disease. And painful extremities, this is again a characteristic feature. And they are also associated with heart disease.
Which of the following neurocutaneous syndromes affect ocular motility? Tuberous sclerosis, incontinentia pigmenti, ataxia telangiectasia, von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, Sturge-Weber syndrome.
Right, so that's again, I think we all saw that. We saw the video of ocular motility apraxia. Which is a characteristic feature in ataxia telangiectasia. None of the other neurocutaneous syndromes may give rise to any ocular motility problems.
The next one, corneal opacities are a feature of which of the following conditions? Cystinosis, homocystinuria, Wilson's disease, mucopolysaccharidosis, galactosemia.
Right, thank you. Yes, cystinosis, we saw the corneal crystals that are deposited in cystinosis. And homocystinuria, as we said, the characteristic feature is a subluxated lens. So corneas are clear. Wilson's disease will give rise to the cleft rings. We saw the pictures of that. And most of the mucopolysaccharidosis give rise to a ground glass opacification of the cornea. With regards to galactosemia, the characteristic feature is the eye droplet cataract, and they don't have corneal opacities.
Okay, the next one is regarding pigmentary retinopathies, which are actually hereditary disorders of photoreceptors. Pigmentary retinopathy is a feature of which of the following conditions? Kearns-Sayre syndrome, A beta lipoproteinemia, Refsum disease, Waardenburg syndrome, Usher syndrome.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Kearns-Sayre is one of the causes of pigmentary retinopathy, but the pigmentary retinopathy is not that significant and it comes on later in life. Their classical features are the ocular motility problems, near total external ophthalmoplegia, ptosis, and they have cardiac anomalies, mainly heart block. So A beta lipoproteinemia is a disorder of lipid metabolism, and they have a series of malabsorption syndromes, and they can be associated with a pigmentary retinopathy. Refsums also give rise to a pigmentary retinopathy. They have a kind of coarse skin, that is also associated with a pigmentary retinopathy. Waardenburg syndrome has retinal lesions, but those are not the pigmentary retinopathy, but large kind of depigmented areas of the retina. And Usher syndrome, as you know, is associated with deafness, and the cause of visual loss is the pigmentary retinopathy. Next one.
So next question, actually we discussed about it. Kernsal syndrome is characterized by the following features: ptosis, external ophthalmoplegia, corneal opacities, autosomal recessive inheritance, and heart block.
Right, so we discussed most of these. So they don't have corneal opacities. Of course, they can develop corneal ulceration, but you don't classify it as corneal opacity primarily, because corneal opacities can occur, but that is secondary to ulceration. Now, the inheritance pattern, Kernsare is a mitochondrial disorder, along with a few other mitochondrial disorders, and it can cause heart block. So yes, next one.
Okay, so now let's move on to the picture quiz. So the first one, this is a fundal photo. It's of a premature neonate who was referred for a routine retinopathy of prematurity examination. And the retinal appearance was like this.
Right.
So questions are, what is the investigation you would order? And how can you treat this condition? So what is the investigation and how to treat this condition?
Right. So as you know, if you look at the retina, you'll see that the retinal vessels are basically white. So that is because they are filled with lipids. And so this is called as lipemia retinalis. And to confirm the diagnosis, you need to do a lipid profile. Usually you'll find very high levels of triglycerides. And how do you treat? So you have to use lipid-lowering drugs. You usually would get an expert opinion on this, but drugs like fenofibrates can be used to treat the condition. And surprisingly, you can get a kind of a cholesterol of about 4,000, and just with the commencement of drugs, they can be brought down to near normal. Next one.
Okay, the next one. It's of a 2-year-old child who was referred due to developmental regression, and the fundal appearance was like this. So what is the abnormality that you see? What is the most likely diagnosis? What broad category of diseases that this disease belongs to? What is the abnormality? What is the most probable diagnosis? What is the broad category of diseases?
Right. So what the abnormality you see, it's what we call the bullseye maculopathy. So there are two like concentric rings of color change located around the fovea. And also you see a kind of a mottled appearance of the fovea. So usually it starts with the mottled appearance and then progresses to a bullseye maculopathy. So I think we saw a picture during the lecture as well. So this is the characteristic appearance of Batten's disease. And to see, it belongs to the broad category of neuronal ceroid lipofuscinosis. So there are a series of conditions and they will exhibit this appearance to varying degrees.
The next one is of a 3-year-old with progressive drooping of right upper lip. And he was found to have some skin lesions also. So identify the clinical findings. What is the condition to be suspected? What are the problems associated with the above condition of the upper lip? So what are the clinical findings? What is the condition to be suspected? And what are the problems due to the problem of the upper lip?
Right. So if you look at the upper lip on the right side, you see what's called an S shape ptosis. And that is due to the presence of a neurofibroma in the eyelid. And then if you look at the other picture, you see multiple capillary spots all over the body. And so what is the condition? It's NF1. And with the upper lid, so obviously there are cosmetic concerns. And the other thing is that due to the ptosis, especially if it occurs in a younger child, it can cause obscuration of the visual axis. And because of that, that can give rise to what's called amblyopia, because the child doesn't see out of that eye. The visual development of that eye doesn't take place. And because of that, even if you correct the problem later in life, the child will not be able to regain normal vision. And also there is a high chance of developing glaucoma in that eye.
The next one is of a 20-year-old with progressive tinnitus and hearing loss and underwent MRI brain, which shows this picture, which is there's a pretty obvious MRI finding. Identify the imaging findings. What is the systemic condition to be suspected? And what are the ocular manifestations of the above condition? So what is the imaging finding? The condition to be suspected. And what are the ocular features of the above condition?
Yeah.
The answers.
If you look at the MRI, you see that there are bilateral CP angle tumors. These are acoustic neuromas. And acoustic neuromas are characteristically associated with neurofibromatosis type 2. And there are some ophthalmic conditions, what we call posterior subcapsular cataracts, and the lesion which is described as a combined hamartoma of the retina and the pigment epithelium. I think we saw some pictures. And also there can be development of epiretinal membranes, which can cause some obscuration of vision.
So the next one is of a 10-year-old with a family history of retinal tumor who presented with progressive loss of vision of the left eye. So here, this is the fundal photo. To make it easier, you can see the optic disc. There's the macula. And you can see some dilated vessels going towards the well-circumscribed sort of a mass. So identify the retinal pathology. What is the systemic condition or syndrome that can be associated with this? And what are the extraocular manifestations of the above syndrome? So identify the retinal pathology. What is the syndrome associated with it? And what are the ocular manifestations of the above syndrome?
So what you see a fairly large lesion there, which is the retinal capillary hemangioblastoma. And due to that, there is some leakage around that and dilated vessels. The leakage will cause fluid accumulating in the retina. In this case, it has affected the macula, and that is why there is a reduction in vision. So the condition is the hemangioblastoma associated with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. And so there are a lot of problems with this. You get lesions all over the body. CNS hemangiomas are by far the most of concern. And also two malignancies, pheochromocytoma and renal cell carcinoma and renal lymphatic sac tumors. And also you get multiple cysts all over the body, liver, pancreas, kidney, gonads, everywhere. So these children have to be followed up long term. They have to have serial MRIs to detect the abdominal complications.
So this is a 9 months old baby who presented with unilateral discoloration of the face. Identify the clinical feature. What is the associated syndrome? What are the main features of the above syndrome? And what are the ocular manifestations of the above syndrome? So what is the clinical feature? What is the associated syndrome? What are the main features of the syndrome? And what are the ocular manifestations of the above syndrome?
Right, so you get this malformation, which is known as a porphyrin stain. In this case, it's affecting the ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, but it can affect the other divisions as well. And so the condition is Sturgible. And so you get this vascular malformation and also vascular malformations in the brain. So ocular manifestations, so glaucoma is by far the most worrying. And as I said, it's difficult to treat. And also you get a choroidal hemangioma, which gives a kind of a different color to the retina of that type. So if you compare the two eyes, you see that the colors are different in the two eyes. Okay, next one.
Okay, it's of a 15-year-old who presented with bilateral progressive vision loss and was found to have corneal clouding. And he underwent anterior segment photos and which revealed these findings. So what is the most likely diagnosis and any other differential diagnosis? And what is the main systemic association of the above condition? What is the most probable diagnosis? Any other differential diagnosis? And what is the main systemic association of the above condition?
Right, so this is cystinosis. You can see the corneal crystals and they manifest gradually over time. And it's the similar condition is Schneider dystrophy, which has some, gives rise to kind of a deposition of crystals and gives a similar picture. So the main systemic issue is renal problems. So we have to keep a watch for renal problems in these children. Is that the last one, Chalika? Is there one?
Yes, sir.
That's the last. So thank you very much. Thank you everybody for giving us this opportunity. And Chalika, would you like to say a few words as well?
Yes, sir. I would like to thank the College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka and the Sri Lanka Medical Association for the opportunity given, and also for the participation of for the people who was listening to this lecture. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the whole team, led by Dr. Ramani Siniviratna, the president of the College of Ophthalmologists of Sri Lanka. Thank you very much, Dr. K. Nuruttan. Thank you, Dr. Hiranya Abhisekara. Thank you, Dr. Ravisha Udupihilla. Thank you, Dr. Chanika Kamagi. I think there's time for us for discussion. I don't see any questions, of course. If there is any more remarks that you need to make. I think I really enjoyed the whole presentation because it was so easy to understand for anyone because of the pictures and the slides that you used to communicate the message. I'm certain that it was a useful session for all who joined online. So let me communicate my sincere gratitude to College of Ophthalmologists for collaborating with the Sri Lanka Medical Association in organizing this, and for all resource persons for agreeing to share your expertise with the trainees as well as the other doctors who are interested on the subject. So thank you very much again. Let us conclude the session. Thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, Mandy.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Banata. Thank you.